Hi, I'm Norbert Babos, the technical director at SolarKit. In this video, I'll show you how to commission a newly installed Huawei system when you have a battery and a backup box. The first step is to power up the entire system, both on the AC and DC sides. To do this, you'll need to switch on the DC switch located at the bottom of the inverter, the DC switch on the battery side, the circuit breaker for the inverter, and the small backup load breaker on the backup box as well. Once we've switched them on, the inverter will take about a minute to power up and allow us to connect to it with our phone. We'll wait for that. You can open the Fusion Solar app on your phone, and I recommend that you always keep it updated via the App Store or Google Play. Updates are released quite frequently, and sometimes new features are only available in the latest version. So whenever there's an update, it's a good idea to install it to ensure you have access to all the options. When you're setting up a system for the first time, after you log into the inverter, which we'll see in a moment, you won't be able to perform any further configurations until the inverter's firmware is updated to the latest version. The app will automatically prompt you with the update, so there's no need to search for it manually. It's important to complete this firmware update, as it's required to proceed with the rest of the commissioning process. Now let's take a look at how this looks in practice. Now click on Services and then Commission Device. A small window will appear where you can scan the inverter's QR code, which you'll find on the side of the unit. So we have two options. If you've already logged in before, you will have set a password, and in this case, the app will only ask you to enter that password in a single field. However, if this is a brand new installation and you've never logged into the inverter before, you'll see two empty fields under the installer account. In these fields, you'll need to create a new password, which will be used for local logins as the installer. This password will allow you to access the inverter for any future configuration or troubleshooting needs. When you log into the inverter, in our case, it already had the latest firmware. However, if it didn't, before you're fully logged in, the app would automatically prompt you to perform an inverter firmware upgrade. This is a mandatory step, and the process runs automatically. It takes about 5 to 6 minutes to complete, after which the inverter will restart. Once it has restarted, you'll need to give it a few more minutes to fully boot up and stabilize before continuing with the setup, and then log into the inverter again. Once you've logged in, if the inverter firmware is already up to date, the app won't prompt for another update. However, if there's a new firmware available for the battery, that will come up next. This is also a mandatory step, and you won't be able to proceed with any other tests until the battery firmware is updated. It takes a bit longer, around 20 minutes. It all comes down to whether there's sufficient sunlight or not. Ideally, you'll want to carry out the setup process during daylight hours when sunlight is available, as this will ensure things run more efficiently. Without sunlight, and therefore no direct DC power, the battery update process can slow down significantly. This update typically takes around 20 minutes to complete, and once it's complete, the battery will reboot. After that, the entire system will be ready to operate with the latest versions of both the inverter and the battery firmware. Once that's done, the system will then prompt you with the next step. It will bring up the next screen, like the one I see here. Now from here, you'll need to select your location right away. If you're in Hungary, you'll select Hungary. Then for the grid code, you'll choose VDE ARN 4105 and check that option. The app will also sync the time automatically with your phone. In the device management section, you'll see all the devices connected to the inverter. You can see that we have a dongle, which is lit up in green, indicating it's properly connected. There's also a power meter located here, and the battery, which is a 15 kilowatt unit shown below it. Each of these devices has a small green connection icon in the corner, indicating that they've been successfully recognized by the system. At this point, we can be happy that no communication issues need troubleshooting. If one of the devices isn't recognized, instead of the green connection icon in the corner, you'll see a gray one. In the worst case scenario, if the device was previously recognized but lost its signal, the icon will appear as a broken gray connection, indicating that the communication has been interrupted. Now, if you have a backup box, the inverter won't automatically detect it. The backup box won't show up in the device management list. Instead, it has its own separate menu, which we'll cover later. So don't worry if you don't see it listed with the other devices here. You'll need to pay attention to the backup box to ensure it's properly connected. During the setup, the inverter will first search for optimizers on the DC side. It's usually a good idea to wait for this process to complete, but you can continue with setting up the Wi-Fi in the meantime. I prefer to wait for the optimizer check to finish to ensure everything is working smoothly. There's no rush, so it's worth waiting the 2 or 3 minutes to see the progress percentage and check if the optimizers have been detected. This way, you can be sure everything is working correctly. If you have a system with multiple inverters connected in series, you'll need to go to the cascaded inverters section. There's a small inverter icon with a plus sign. Click on that. I'll just show you here by clicking and you'll see the plus sign. In the networking mode, select RS485 as no other options are available at this point, and then click on search for cascaded inverters. The system will then begin searching and it will display a list of any connected inverters it finds. If we had another inverter connected here and this one is set as the master, while the slave inverter has no communication device like a dongle attached, only panels or maybe even a battery, the serial number of the slave inverter will appear in the list and a small green check mark will indicate successful communication. Once you see the green check mark, you can simply go back one step and you'll see cascaded inverter, one displayed with the serial number and a green check mark next to it. If that's all set up properly, then you know the communication between the inverters is working as expected. You won't need to configure it separately. Everything can be controlled through the master inverter, and the slave inverter will automatically copy its settings. In our case, we don't have any optimizers installed right now, so the success here will be finding zero optimizers. If it finds anything, that would be quite surprising. The optimizer search was successfully completed, and as expected, we have zero optimizers detected. So we can move on to the battery control interface. Here, we need to specify the installation environment for the ESS. Obviously, they want to emphasize that the ESS shouldn't be installed outdoors, not like in the middle of a waterfall, but rather in a more suitable protected location. At this point, you'll need to specify whether the system is installed outdoors, maybe under an eave or a small roof, or indoors, such as in a garage. In our case, it's not exactly a garage, but it is indoors. We'll select the garage option. Then there's the maximum self-consumption setting, where you have three options to choose from. The maximum self-consumption mode, which is what we recommend selecting, allows the battery to operate autonomously. If there's excess energy stored in the battery and you need power on the AC side and the solar panels aren't producing enough, the battery will assist by supplying energy to meet your consumption. On the other hand, if there's surplus energy from the solar panels, it will be stored in the battery and can be used later, like in the evening when you need power. The second option is fully fed to grid, where all the energy is fed back into the grid instead of being stored or used locally. In Hungary, the fully fed to grid option isn't really relevant and isn't commonly used, so we don't recommend it. Then there's the time of use mode, where you can set specific time intervals for the battery to operate in certain ways. However, this feature doesn't have much use here either at the moment. So we'll stick with the maximum self-consumption option, as it's the most practical for our setup. And we'll go on to the network settings. For the domain name, it's best to leave it as Fusion Solar Global, which is the INTLS server address used for the system. Below that, you'll need to enter the available Wi-Fi network. It's important to note that the inverter can only connect to a 2.4 GHz network, so if you have a 5 GHz network, it won't work. Here, you simply enter the name of the local network that the inverter has found, and then type in the password to connect. At the top, make sure to check the box indicating that you've received permission from the user to connect to their network. Once that's done, the inverter will first attempt to connect to the local Wi-Fi network. If that's successful, it will then try to reach the Fusion Solar server based on the domain name. If everything goes well, you'll see green check marks across the board, and you can be relieved that there are no communication issues, since dealing with communication problems can often be quite tricky. Great, all the green check marks are there and we've successfully connected. We hit next, and now we can see the summary. The system detects everything. This means our system is working properly and we can press finish. At this point, the system is fully operational and turned on. The battery is now charging, and by default, it feeds back to the grid and charges the battery without any limits. However, these settings can be fully customized, so let's go through how to adjust them properly. After commissioning the inverter, the first thing to do is set it up on the monitoring system. You'll need to create a location for it and assign it to the end user, so the customer can monitor everything using their own email address. And how do we do that? You need to do this in the Fusion Solar app as well. Once the inverter has been commissioned, it's important to ensure you're not connected to the inverter's Wi-Fi, but to the local Wi-Fi network. At this point, it's a good idea to switch over to a different Wi-Fi network or mobile data, because if you stay connected to the inverter's Wi-Fi, it won't work with anything since there's no internet access through that connection. So from here, go back to the main menu and you'll see an option at the bottom right called Me and then Plant Management with a plus sign at the top right. This is where you can create a new site. Set the country region to Hungary, and for plant type, choose residential, as we're dealing with a household installation. EV charger only plant is an option you select only if you've installed an EV charger, so it won't try to include functions related to an inverter. In our case, we'll select no, since we don't have an EV charger installed. For the site name, the app will automatically detect and fill in the address and time zone. Great, now check the box at the bottom to confirm that the customer has given permission for monitoring. Then use the little plus icon to scan the inverter's QR code. At this point, the system will automatically detect that it's using a dongle-based communication without any extra steps needed on your part. You then enter the system size, for example, 12.4 kilobar on the roof, and hit submit. That's it, your site is now set up. It immediately prompts you to create a user for the system, allowing you to complete this step as well in one go. At the select provider step, you need to choose your company as the installer. The person creating the account is the owner, so under role, select owner to assign them as the system's owner. When adding to the associated plants, there are two ways to link the customer to the site. One option is to select them from the list, but since we have around 3,000 systems, loading the list might take a bit longer, which is why I'm intentionally showing this method. But if you tap on the small QR icon for scanning, you can simply scan the QR code again, and it will automatically recognize which site it is. This method is a bit quicker, especially if you have a lot of systems or locations to choose from. After that, you just need to enter the customer's email address so the system knows where to send the registration email, type in the email, check the box to confirm the customer has given permission, and click invite. The customer will then receive an email with a link to register. This process has changed from before, when we had to manually create usernames and passwords. Now Huawei sends a single email directly to the customer, and in that email, there will be a link that allows the customer to register. They create their own password and complete the entire registration process by themselves. So in summary, setting up the site is really that simple. Once the site is created and the end user has their account, they can log in and monitor the system. Everything works perfectly and the user has full access to track their site's performance. So that's pretty much all there is to it.